Hi, everybody. Hello. Nice to see you all. Michael Shermer here, director of the Skeptic Society and the publisher of Skeptic Magazine. And we are here for our final science salon for the spring. We're dark for the summer, and we'll pick up again in September. Just working on booking some guests, possibly. You'll like this. Mm-hmm. Roger Penrose may be our guest for September. He's coming to Southern California from England on a book tour, and so we're hoping to get him. So stay in touch with us through eSkeptic. It's free. It's our weekly electronic magazine. If you go to skeptic.com and just sign up there, then you'll get the notices of upcoming events. We are, as always, thankful to Jackie and David Nadich to allow us to use their beautiful home. Thank you. We appreciate that. So our guest, Stephon Alexander, is a professor of physics at Brown University, where he also got his PhD and is now teaching the very courses he used to take, which I think is cool. He has a BS from Haverford College, and he did postdocs at Imperial College, London, and at the Stanford Linear Accelerator. He's also taught at Penn State and Haverford. He was profiled on PBS's The Secret Life of Scientists and Engineers, where the lab coats come off. These are some fun clips to watch where he plays his saxophone, but you don't have to watch it there because you can see it live here. And he's also done TEDx talks and other popular talks about his combination of physics and music. So he's a theoretical physicist specializing in the interface between cosmology, particle physics, and quantum gravity, specifically string gravity and loop quantum gravity, as well as quantum inflation, structure formation, singularity resolution, string cosmology, and quantum fields and curved spaces, which is all the fields I was going to do until I found out you had to do math. So I ended up in the social sciences. my old job.
That's hard for me.
You get to do that. His parents are from Trinidad, and they moved to the Bronx in New York when he was 8. And his life was changed, really, with a 10th grade teacher who threw a ball up in the air. So I thought, why don't we start with first sort of background to how you came into this whole thing with that story.
Okay, sure. Well, first of all, it's a real pleasure, honor to be here, and especially to see some young faces in the audience. Hopefully I can learn something from your questions today. So that story began with this teacher. Well, first of all, let me establish that. How many of you know what the word truant is, a truant?
Truant, yes. Something
good. I assume
it's
that there
good
was,
that they don't
there was
know
some,
that.
Fellow, some fellow truants in the audience. Right? All right. So I kind of was like a truant. School bored me, and I preferred to sneak off and play basketball. Every young man at that time in the Bronx dreamt of being the next Michael Jordan, even if you were 5'1". You know, you thought you were going to be Michael Jordan. So, the 10th grade, this is actually one thing I want to just actually say. It's very interesting that in the New York City public school system, my school is a public school, 6,000 students, David Clinton High School. The way the science curriculum happened, right, was very interesting. It's the reverse of what's going on to these days. You learn physics first. So we had physics, then chemistry, then biology. That was the sequence. So in 10th grade, I was in a particular track, and we took physics first, okay? And I found that, in hindsight, that really, really worked. Mr. Kaplan was his name. Everyone was scared of this class because it's physics, right? And you hear all this crazy stuff, equations and whatever. So anyway, this guy walks in the room, but he doesn't go to the blackboard. He literally goes in the middle of the class and sits on somebody's desk. And then, of course, people are like, this guy's a weirdo. Like, well, why is he here? What's he doing there? And then he proceeds to go into his inside pocket. And that's when the bad dudes in the back of the room started to get nervous. and he pulls out a tennis ball. And he says, first lesson. He didn't say that, but it was the first lesson. And he threw the ball in the air and caught it. And he said, the speed of the ball was zero when it was at its peak height. What is the speed of the ball right when it hit my hand, right when it returned to my hand, at the moment it hit my hand? And so, you know, some of the more studious students in the front were trying to do some calculations. This is our very first class. There were no equations. We didn't know any physics there. And at that point, I started to imagine in my head just the picture, a cartoon ball going up and down, up and down, up and down. And I sort of, you know, instinctively just rose my hand. I would never do that in classes, by the way. And he jumped at that and said, "What's the answer?" I said, "The velocity is exactly the same as when it left your hand." And this guy jumped up as if he won the lottery. And he said, "You know, the wellspring of a great physicist is the intuition." And then he proceeded to the blackboard to derive the famous conservation of energy. He said, "What you just saw was a conservation of energy." And for some reason, you know, it was the first time that any teacher, for that matter, exuded that I had something. And that was an important step, an important moment, just that a teacher that actually, he was known to be like the smartest teacher in the whole school. He was the chair of both the music department and the physics department.
Oh, perfect for you.
Had started his life as a composer, but then the Korean War, you know, brought him to radar technology and came back and became a high school teacher. And could have taught at any high school in New York City, Bronx High School of Science, many of you, a lot of famous Nobel Prize winning physicists from Bronx Science. My school was the thug school next to Bronx Science,
right?
And he chose to teach at my at Clinton.
Oh, lucky you.
Yeah, so it was a...
So just as a point of physics, the energy is conserved because the energy pushes it up and gravity pulls it down, and they're equal? Is that the right way to say that?
That's right. So gravity actually, the higher you go up, gravity actually stores potential energy. So right now we're on top of this hill. We have a lot of potential energy right now because of gravity and the height. So don't want to jump off this cliff, because you will release all that energy and it will transfer itself into kinetic energy of the equivalent amount of the potential energy expended. And that will transfer itself into speed, all right?
Until you hit the bottom.
Until you go splat.
Until you go splat, yeah. Yes. So the your interest in physics and, well, music in general, jazz in particular, were roughly around the same time,
caffeine.
High school?
Yeah,
and caffeine. There's a lot of good stories about drinking caffeine with famous physicists in this book, and musicians.
Is there a caffeine society, like whatever?
Well, we have a skeptic society. We should have a caffeine society. Well, I think pretty much every academic conference is a caffeine society. Yes. So, one of the themes I liked about the book was, when I initially saw it, the jazz of physics, I thought, well, it's sort of an analogy between physics and music. But as I was reading it, clearly you mean more than just an analogy, that the universe or the physical world has a musical or sound or audible or, but what? What does that mean exactly?
Yeah, it's pretty spectacular. So many of us know that the universe has been expanding, right? We didn't believe this. It was until the 20s that it was really the case that the universe was expanding, because we, Hubble took pictures of galaxies and saw that galaxies are all flying apart. And now we have other independent ways of measuring the expansion rate of our universe. So it means that if you run the clock backwards, right, things are much closer together, hotter and denser. So all of the matter in our universe, planets, stars, galaxy, will then dissociate under that very huge, very large, you know, very hot condition, and will dissociate back into radiation energy. So in the early stages of the universe, it's this hot, this soup, this featureless soup, chaotic soup of radiation energy. So the question in physics, one of the most important questions in cosmology, my field of research, is to understand how a featureless early universe that's very hot, dense, and much smaller, all right, developed later on, evolved, I will use that word, evolved to form the myriad structures, the cosmic, we call the cosmic web, of how all the galaxies and stars are interlaced into this network that spans thousands of millions of light years, okay, that our galaxy belongs to. So it turns out that physics, and it could have been any other sort of physics, it could have been, you know, the physics, it could have just, if, in fact, we know this because we can study Einstein's theory, and these very daunting and beautiful equations tell an interesting story, that if you look at it from the right perspective, what appears to be really complicated ends up becoming the physics of sound. So what we now know is that the early stages of the universe, all right, the undulations of this highly energetic plasma radiation are sound waves, like the sound waves you're hearing in my voice, okay, which is nothing more than the vibration of that radiation. And the energy in those sound waves collapse to form the first stars and galaxies. Okay, so that's, so we know that that's the correct physics to do that. And later on, I will demonstrate that physics with the saxophone.
But it's a little bit, it's not sound like we think of sound, right? Because we always hear, well, you can't scream in space because there's no, you know, so when the rocket ships blow up in Star Wars and they make a big sound, that's not real because there's no air. But you mean sound by just vibrating. But we also think of space or space-time as just empty, but it's not really, I mean, there's something that's vibrating in.
That's right. So that's a very good point. So what it is, what's vibrating is this radiation energy that fills the universe like an ocean. So the universe is filled with this radiation. In particular, it's really light and, you know, light energy that's dissociated from very hot electrons, and the light is bouncing around. Very similar to the surface of the sun. Okay? And the waves exist in that medium. So the universe is not empty. But actually, when we start pushing the analogy of sound further to the earlier stage of the universe, we're going to have to confront that issue.
Okay.
Okay.
I remember one of the, we had Michelle Feynman as one of our science salon guests here, the daughter of Richard Feynman. And so we talked about Feynman diagrams, which you do as well. But I remember him explaining why you can't just fall through the floor, even though atoms are mostly empty space. Why can't you just pass your hand through the book or the floor? You know, because a lot of these New Agers think, well, you know, if you just will it, you can just sort of pass through walls because it's all empty space.
Yeah, I just did that, by the way.
You just
did that? And I came back.
Well, like your friend, you said, oh, I think I can fly. Well, go ahead and jump off. The splat part at the, But Feynman explained it that at the micro level, even though it's mostly empty space, the electrons and protons and neutrons are vibrating, or they're, they're jiggling, he said, But I think he means what you were talking about. It's like a sound vibration. Mm-hmm. So it's really solid because of the jiggling, the vibration,
that's
right?
That's right. So that's the other thing that's interesting. Again, let's go back to the sound thing, that what is sound, right? Sound is nothing more than a pressure wave, right? That the room is filled with air, and some energy now is expended, and it creates a disturbance, and that disturbance travels. And the wave pattern contains the sound that you're going to hear. And that happens also in the surface of the ocean. It turns out that the beautiful thing is when we try to probe the very structure, the building blocks of matter itself, like you go beyond the periodic table, and we start asking what is things made up of, we discover it's made up of fields, that everything is made up of what we call quantum fields. You're very familiar with a field already if you play with magnets. You don't see the magnetic field, right? But it acts on the other magnet without ever touching the magnet. That means there's this field that bends, and its distortion, right, carries a force. And so what we discovered, in fact, what Richard Feynman discovered, was that when you probe deeper into even the matter, right, or everything are like magnets, they're made up of magnetic fields, right? And the pattern, the vibrational pattern of these fields, determine the structure that matter might have. And so the same physics of sound that we are familiar with auditorially, we can import that physics as an analogy to understand a lot of modern physics. And that's kind of what I attempted to do in the book.
Now, by a field, so my job here is to ask dumb questions because I don't really understand this stuff.
Yeah, I don't know field theory.
but an atomic, I mean, we think of an atom as uncuttable, so it's a smallest particle or element that there is, but if I understand it, you going deeper than that, they're not even really particles, they're fields.
They're fields, yeah.
Okay, so that's just energy, that's just sound, that's just vibrate.
Yes.
I'm not sure I'm even saying it right.
So it's a vibrational pattern that's fixed. So a good example of this is a string, a guitar string. You know, if you watch a guitar string closely enough, it appears as if like it's not moving. Like you watch a fan, it's moving. You see actually a part that's not moving at all, right? So we call that a standing wave pattern. It's a wave pattern that actually is frozen. Okay? Now, why it's frozen actually is very interesting. Because what's really going on is you have a wave going to the left, all right, and a wave going to the right. And when they interact, it creates a wave that stands, like stands still. It's very similar when you watch, I was just at Half Moon Bay visiting a friend in California. We are in California.
Yeah. It's a big state. It's a long state.
And I was watching very interesting waves coming from, very big waves that coming forward, hitting a wall, right? And you just saw waves coming. And then at some point, I saw something very cool. I saw a lump of water just standing still. What's going on there is the same phenomenon. Wave is coming, it hits, and it gets reflected backwards. And it interferes with the wave coming forward again. And what's left is a standing wave. And the vibrational pattern of quantum fields, like an electron, is like a standing wave pattern of that vibration in a similar way. And that's why it appears to have a solid form. I mean, that's an analogy, but, you know.
Is this what they talk about, like this famous double slit experiment, yes, where on the back wall you get these interference lines?
Yes, that's the wave-like nature.
So the waves are either troughing or cresting.
That's right. So the electron can interfere with itself as a wave pattern, even though it's one electron, right?
Can you explain, this is the weirdest thing. And New Agers love this.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Because it means that, you know, not everything is as it appears. So however I want the universe to be, I can will it to be because of it. But that's not really what it means. I mean, the observer can be anything. It doesn't have to be a human. It could be camera or whatever, right?
That's right. Yeah. I mean, you know, let's say
so
that
you're shooting these individual photons through two slits, and but they act like they're interacting even though they're just one at a time.
Yes.
So it's a wave and a particle.
It's a wave, I would say, yeah, it is a wave and a particle, right? And depending on the environment it finds itself, it might behave more like the wave or more like the particle. It tends to be very aware of its environment.
See, that's where it gets weird. Right? So, I mean, we're talking about the nature of reality. But let's go back to music for a minute. So, in 10th grade, you start. I'm always curious about how people's life trajectories go, particularly for students deciding what they're going to do. So you might go down the path of physics and science, but then you also discover Kenny G and then Coltrane and realize, oh my God, there's the elevator jazz and then there's the real jazz. Maybe I can do that. Mm-hmm. So at some point you must have decided, you know, do I want to be because every guy dreams of being a rock star or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Or a magician.
Right.
Or
right. Yeah, right.
On stage or, you know, doing science. So how did you decide what, or you kind of do both, but really you're a professional scientist.
Yeah, well, part of the book actually was a reconciliatory process. I was always torn throughout my life about whether or not I was more fit to be a scientist or a musician, whether or not I don't know, but let me just put something on the table here. It's not a table, but there were lots of pressures, right? Societal pressures, you know, when I watched TV, the scientists didn't act like me, right? I wasn't cool enough to be the musician, but I had a passion for both. So throughout my career thus far, my life, I was always struggling within myself, trying to reconcile how to, you know, be one or the other, or both. And so the book's kind of about that path. And one of the things going back to was, just the fact that people like John Coltrane, Mr. Kaplan, we'll talk about Eno in a second, they were individuals that inspired me in the following way. They just didn't seem to care what others thought. Richard Feynman was like that too. And they just pursued their passion. And so it was that kind of inspiration that said, okay, I have to find my own way of having these two things speak, and that's just, you know, speak to each other, right? So let me just forewarn you guys. I am not saying in my book that the universe is a jazz composition, okay? Right? All I'm really trying to do here is to reconcile these two passions. I know enough about both of these things to be able to say new things and to speak about the physics that I love and so passionate about in a new way, you know, because other popular science books they talk about Jenny jumping up on a trampoline and talk to, you know, about gravitational waves.
Right.
I want to talk about a saxophone, you know, generating a gravitational wave.
Another thing I got from the book that I hadn't really thought about was, we think of science as discovering things that are actually really out there, and the equations describe them correctly or accurately. But we often think of music as just sort of a cultural thing. There's classical and jazz and rock, and you know, they're all just sort of out there, they're different styles. But you sort of talk about that there are some real patterns of music that are really, really good. They're really out there. The note that because of why? Harmony, our brains are evolved to perceive those notes as, you know, more inharmonious than others, and
so
there's something real about you. In a way, you're discovering something out there.
So that's a good point, and that only you know, it's funny, of all the I guess 15 or so talks I've given so far, you're the first person to actually nail this one, which is So this is very interesting, which is, we think that, you know, when we think about music versus science, music is often called a language of emotion. It's purely the subjective thing, right? You know, because it evokes emotions. And some people don't want to talk about music in a scientific terms. No, just, I don't want to talk about this piece that I got married to or whatever in a scientific way, you know? And likewise, science is about, you know, physics especially, mathematical equations, fact, true or false. Actually, one of the things that I do in the book is actually sort of show that there is a stylistic, you know, there is a cultural side to science and to doing science, right? There isn't just one mode to engage scientific research, okay? And actually, there are some objective things about music. And what I mean by that is that there is a sense in which music, in the ancients, I talk about the ancient realm where music and science were one, going back to the Pythagoreans, okay, where there was never a separation between music and musical thinking and the way the universe operated, all right? But there's a sense in which music transcends even the existence of humans. So in other words, it's sort of like, are the laws of physics a human construct, or the mathematics, or is it something that's generated in our brain? It's a similar kind of question. And Roger Penrose is one of the big champions of this idea of the Platonic realm, and you're here, but I'll leave that to him. But in a similar way, I came to this pseudo conclusion, okay, that there might be this sense in which music transcends. You know, we discover music. The same way, so every song that's written is a discovery, okay? That's already, in a sense, already out there. And one piece of evidence for that is that the universe seems to be functioning musically, okay? Yeah, you see?
That's the universe.
That's it.
Well, you have this great quote from...
I'm gonna go fly now.
You have this great, on the one hand, Einstein used mathematical rigor, on the other, creativity and intuition. He was an improviser at heart, just like his hero, Mozart. Einstein once said, "Mozart's music is so pure and beautiful that I see it as a reflection of the inner beauty of the universe." You know, and Mozart does stand out still as one of the greats of all time, and that's not arbitrary.
It's not. I don't think it's arbitrary.
You could almost say not that he created great music, he did, but he discovered certain patterns, would you say, of notes that are really better.
Yeah. As did Bach, as did John Coltrane.
Yeah.
You know, as did some of the incredible melodies of the Beatles, you know. Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, when we look at patterns, you know, I'll just give you an example to make this a little bit more. So when we look at, for example, you know, my saxophone or musical instrument, right? The type of wave patterns that it's producing, right? These wave patterns actually carry information, okay, that reflects geometrical patterns, all right? And that's, you know, that's something that is better, I bet it's better to demonstrate later on with the instrument. But so in a lot of ways, music, if you ask a lot of composers, if you corner them and say, I want you to define music, they'll, a good definition is music is structured sound, okay? Structured sound. And so the word structure is very important. You go to any biologist and ask them, what's the most important theme in biology? It's structure function, the relationship between the structure of a biological thing and how that structure informs the function, right? I'm sure even in the stuff that you dabble in. So we're interested in the structure. And so let's go back to the question about our universe. What we are interested in cosmology is we do have very powerful telescopes that could look for the patterns or the structure and how galaxies are interweaved with each other. Why are we interested in that? Because that structure formed using the laws of physics. And if the laws of physics that's doing this, that the laws come together to do something that looks like sound patterns, then that looks like a composition, right? Because a musical composition has structure, right? I mean, so we can get into that.
The cosmic background radiation, yeah. The 3 degrees.
Yeah.
You tune your radio or TV between, and you get the fuzz. And that's the background noise from the initial explosion.
Yes.
And that's a vibration or a sound. It's a vibration. In a way.
And it may not be too interesting to our ears, right, that vibration, but it's the vibration that led to all this stuff. So it is interesting to us. It's interesting to beyond our ears, right? Because it's literally that sound pattern that, right, developed into the complex structures that we are a part of.
One of the more interesting chapters here is entitled Eno, the Sound Cosmologist. I didn't know there was such a thing as a sound cosmologist.
I made that up.
You made that up. Okay, good.
He's happy about that.
Tell us about Brian Eno and your encounters with him. He's one of the more interesting characters in today's world.
To the young people, how many of you guys know Brian Eno, the name Brian Eno? I didn't, okay, the older people in the audience know. I didn't know. So I didn't know who Brian Eno was when I first met him, too. I actually met Brian Eno at a quantum gravity cocktail party, okay, in London, not even in London. We don't have these kind of things in America. I saw a guy in the back of the room at this cocktail. It's like a similar kind of thing to this. And he had a strong face, a bald guy with a gold tooth. So I went up to, we interacted. It turned out to be Brian Eno. He is a very famous producer. He produced like U2. He discovered and produced a band called U2, The Talking Heads, Coldplay, Dido. I mean, like everybody. He's produced everybody. But he's actually trained as a visual artist. He has no musical training. Well, that's not true. Yes, he knows a lot of music, but he pretends like he doesn't. Right.
It makes it look better when
he's like a skeptic, yeah. The ultimate skeptic. So Brian and I, we hung out a lot when I lived in London. We became friends. I would say he became like a mentor of mine. And that was an important time of my life as a musician and a scientist, because Brian was the one that gave me the sort of show. He was applying scientific ideas in his musical compositions and his art. And I call him the sound cosmologist because one day, this guy's very famous, okay, like, and very accomplished. He won like over 10 Grammy Awards and everything in the book, right? I mean, so one day he goes, you know, Stephon, you know, I want to be called a cosmologist, you know. I was like, like, you're Brian Eno, dude, like, you know. So this was a little present to him when I wrote this book, like, called The Sound Cosmologist. But I had to figure out a good way to, like, you know, make it legit. So he's a sound cosmologist. And why? Why did I do that? Brian Eno is the world's expert in frequency modulation synthesis. He was a person that really revolutionized in the 70s with a band called Roxy Music, the use of synthesizers in rock music. When he produced David Bowie, for example, he introduced a lot of synthesis, like, you know, in rock music. But his approach to that was simplicity. He believed in using very simple wave patterns, manipulating simple wave patterns to create complex music. So from simplicity, you know, grew this rich, complex music that he called generative music. ambient, part of this is called ambient music, right? And that really inspired me when I was hanging out with Brian Eno, watching him use these ideas of simplicity in sciences and important it to make really, really beautiful art and music that was successful and people loved. And I said, well, if Brian Eno could do this and be successful, then I should, you know, I should feel free to just, you know, continue to combine my musical ideas with my physics.
Well, in a way, I mean, the whole cosmos began in a single point, the so-called singularity, right?
Yes.
So this is just an infinitely vibrating. Well, I can always ask you what was there before the Big Bang and those kinds of big questions, but it is a curious thing. I mean, how does a scientist approach those kinds of questions?
Okay, that I can answer.
Oh, you know, okay.
Yeah. So, you know, one of the things I tried to do in this book was to provide, the book is also about a method for engaging in the unknown. Oftentimes, so, you know, you guys are gonna definitely go through classes where you're gonna have to learn things that people have already discovered, and you should, but you should be motivated to learn that because that's the means to an end, and the end is the ability to use known things to create new things. So that's kind of that's what a real scientist does. That's what a physicist does. That's what I get paid to do. I get paid to work with other people, or sometimes myself when it's less exciting, to use known things. And we improvise, okay? We make mistakes. We speculate. We do something very similar to what artists do, to create new knowledge and to ask questions about the unknown. And one way we do this is we make analogies. So the book is about one of my greatest scientific mentors. And it was very important that this person came into my life at a time. Because, you know, I grew up in the Bronx, I didn't go to the best schools and everything. Next thing you know, I'm in graduate school with all these super bright people. And the person that took me in as his advisor, as a student, PhD student, was a guy named Leon Cooper. And Leon was like the second youngest, one of the youngest Nobel Prize winners. He won a Nobel Prize when he was 27. So he's a brilliant guy. But he was his own person. You know, he wore fancy Italian suits. He looked like a cool, like he drove fast cars, had shades. And he was one of these really interesting people. And he was a big music lover. And Leon was able to like solve like major problems, not only in physics, but in neuroscience, in medicine. And the way he did it wasn't the way I thought people did it, and where I learned how to study in school. He did it by making parallels between things that would at first never appear to be related to the thing of study. So one example I talk about in the book very quickly, I'm not going to get into any details here, is there was a time when neuroscientists were trying to understand how the brain stores memories from the perspective of neurons and the circuitry in our brain. Very complicated stuff. And Leon was working on this problem, and physicists were able to use the physics of quantum spin and magnetism as an analogy to understand the neural circuitry of the brain. Completely unrelated stuff. But it helped further the field in neuroscience. And now Google uses this stuff for their search engines, this idea of neural networks. So this is an example of like analogy making. And so don't ever, like, you know, if you have any idea and it's very far-fetched and you're trying to make a parallel between how a bird flies and how a star flings around a galaxy, it may be very far-fetched, but the whole point is to try to merge these two things together, and where it fails, so what you find is that you'll find that there's a lot of overlap, of course. Well, you know, the bird and the star is made up of the same stuff to begin with, made up of atoms, right? And you start making this analogy, and then you reach a place, you reach a point where if it's a very, very good analogy, right, what you're going to start seeing is holes in this analogy. And when you focus on those holes is where there's an opportunity to learn something new.
So this gets to the question of creativity and genius and how people come up with new ideas. one of the things I enjoyed about the book was, I don't know if it was Cooper or somebody else that told you, when you're stuck on a hard quantum problem, you'd go play your saxophone at a club, and then a boom, it would just pop into your head.
Yes.
It's almost like you need to know a lot about a particular problem to solve it, but in a way you need to do something completely different, go for a walk, whatever. And then, but that would imply your brain is still working on it, some other part of your brain.
Yes, yes.
And
it
then
must,
it just...
Yeah. It must be, and I, you know, I have one of my good friends, he studies, there's a field now in cognitive neuroscience called creativity. They study creativity. And it's interesting that Albert Einstein used to do the same thing. He'd get stuck on a problem, and many of us know that he played the violin, and he was pretty good violinist, but he also played the piano. He'd just go and just ramble, improvise on the piano until something came, and he'd continue along. Yeah, and this is definitely, I would like to think, but I have very little evidence that there's something special about musical thought and, you know, physics, all right? That's why I wrote the book. But some people do say that it has to do somehow with, you work really hard, you do your best to sort of master the, you know, the techniques, and then you throw it away. I mean, this is a very similar thing with jazz music, right? Charlie Parker, one of the greatest, probably, arguably the greatest improviser in jazz music, and said, you know, practice, 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 but when you're out there playing, throw it all away, right?
Yeah, but you gotta have the skills.
You have to have the skills, yeah.
So, as you're going along on a riff, and you decide to do this, and then that, and then this, it feels random. But it's almost like there's other programs in there running subconsciously from all that practice. So you have a database of different things you could do.
Yes.
And you're just not conscious of how you're engaging those.
Yeah. It's very interesting. And then you can take this analogy and now apply it to the universe. So did the universe get to practice, you know?
The universe got to practice.
Did it get to practice? Because, you know, again, like, if it's like a musical composition, it's playing.
Oh, I see.
Something
okay.
Interesting,
all right.
Some interesting structure. Did it practice as well? I mean, when I say I'm not trying to give the universe any kind of conscious agency
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
But
that,
it has a history.
It has a history. Yeah.
So maybe that's Feynman's path.
You see, there's a.
Yes,
a
see, I read this book.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
maybe you want to give us a little example of your saxophone playing and what that does for you, and how long have you been playing the sax?
On and off. I mean, well, I would like to say I've been playing for like over 30 years,
wow.
But on and off. And there are people who have been playing for 3 years and they play better than me. So don't let the numbers.
I hate that when that happens.
Yeah. I think I chose the right profession at the end of the day, right? I'm happy to do that, but let me actually say a few words about, I think what I'll do is show you something that when I tell my friends who are real expert musicians this, they get blown away but it's so obvious. But it wasn't obvious to me, so it's something that I think I discovered and I want to share it with you, okay?
Yeah.
First I got to get this thing working. All right, so as I talked about wave patterns, this is kind of like a music lesson as well, too. So, as I said, everything in our universe is subject to a form of a vibrational pattern. And sound is just a specific example of, you know, of vibrations. Now, there are all sorts of complicated vibrations. I mean, when you look at the surface of the ocean, you see very chaotic vibrational patterns. But one of the most beautiful ideas in all of physics and engineering, it's used in signal processing, is the idea that the same way if someone comes and speaks Russian to us and a bilingual person is able to translate that Russian into something that we understand in English, right? It's a translation. We have the mathematics and the physics to take any kind of complicated wave pattern and translate it into wave patterns that we comprehend. And the wave patterns that we comprehend, and we have evolved to be able to do this, we shouldn't take it for granted, are pure tones. these pure tones are notes in our musical scale. They're special types of wave pattern. Why are they special? It has to do with they are harmonic wave patterns. They're periodic in the sense that these wave patterns repeat themselves as opposed to doing this kind of stuff. But what I'm saying now is that you can take complicated wave patterns like this and decompose it into a sum of simple harmonic wave patterns. But that wouldn't be cool enough. You can do the reverse. You can construct any kind of complicated wave pattern you would like by adding, right, different bits of simple wave patterns. And this is used, obviously, in computers. All right. This is used in synthesizers. That's how calculators work. All right. So this is the field of signal processing. All right, good. So now let me tell you something that's also very interesting. It turns out that the simple wave patterns, right, they come in different frequencies. What I mean by that is the number of time the wave dips, okay, determines, or how frequently the wave goes up and down determines the frequency. The higher the frequency, the faster the wave goes up and down, and the lower the frequency, the slower it goes up and down. So I'm going to now show you something that's very interesting. Using those two ideas, that I can have a complicated wave, and contained in that complicated waves are waves of different frequencies, okay? That's actually what I'm going to show you, this very interesting musical idea. First of all, I need to warm up. Okay.
Beautiful.
So, I'm going to play for you. Let's see if I play. Low C. That's going to be the note of very low frequency. In fact, this note's going to have one bump. If I play that. Okay, that's a low C. Now I'm going to play high C. It turns out that the wave pattern for the low C to the high C is very, it's just a matter of chopping a wave exactly in half. Hmm. So a wave of twice the frequency gives me the octave, low C and a high C. Our ears hear those noises similar, okay? If I chop the wave in a third, I get another interesting, so I go from a half to now a third. I get this. All right, that's called a perfect fifth. That's in the key of C, that's G. Now that note is actually one of the most consonant notes because it's used all over the place in music. All right, like so pretty much every song you hear uses this relationship, okay? All right, that's another important thing. The third thing I'm gonna show you is this idea. I'm now gonna play C. So I played C for you before, but if I change my fingering to this, only three fingers, I get the G, because I chopped the wave in third. I'm now just gonna play a C, and I'm not gonna move my fingers. Okay, contained in this C, physically, is another vibration, which is the G. Hmm. Now, right, this is a very important concept because it underlies a lot of the physics we're talking about. The physics of the early universe with these vibrational patterns, it's a fairly complex vibrational pattern. Contained in this are these harmonic relationships. All right, so now what I'm gonna do, what I hope to have convinced you of is that this relationship is special. It's special because if I create any vibration, any disturbance, contained in that disturbance is this fifth. All right? Higher harmonics do exist, but this one is energetically favorable. Okay? So what I'm going to do now is a sequence of fifths. I'm going to start with C. Alright, so I just played fifths of each other. What I'm now going to do is reorder those same notes, the same notes I just made from this vibration pattern of fifths. I'm going to reorder them in ascending order from A to G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, right? All right, I just played for you the most universal scale known to humanity. It's called a pentatonic scale. That was a major pentatonic scale. If I started on a different note, that gives me also the minor pentatonic scale. Every culture known to us, cultures that were never able to speak to each other, use a scale. Many popular songs, and I'll leave it up to you guys to go Google, pentatonic scale and songs. You'll be surprised how many R&B songs, how many rock songs, right, are based on this scale. Let me do something a little bit more interesting now. That's a blues scale. I bent one note in the pentatonic scale. I'm playing the pentatonic scale, and all I did was I bent the third, right, note, and I get one of the most popular scales in American music, the blues scale. What I hope to have convinced you of there was that this scale transcends us. I mean, we like it, we use it, we've used it before even knowing the physics, but it actually comes out of physics. All right, let me maybe play a song based on that scale.
That's a beautiful saxophone.
Oh, thank you.
That's not the one your dad bought you, is it? You still have that one?
No, that one is...
The $50 one?
This one is like, I think, 20 times the
price. That's great. That's beautiful. What a beautiful instrument. So you're saying these notes are discovered, essentially. They're really out there.
They're really out there.
Yeah, and they really sound better to our brains, to us. Yes.
Yeah, and like, you know, I have friends who study how the brain perceives music. Some of them claim that they still don't understand why it is we like the pentatonic and the blues scale. But to me, it's like, well, maybe we're asking the wrong question. Because,
You know, these arguments about whether culture is progressing or regressing, and, you know, one of the arguments you hear usually from old guys that are complaining about kids these days and the music they're listening to, and I'm starting to sound like that these days, these younger students I get. Mm. Still, so I try to be careful. But one of the arguments, say, well, classical music was really better than rock music or jazz or whatever. But really, they're using the same principles that are underlying, sort of the physics underlying it.
That's right.
And they're rediscovering it.
That's right.
So it's not that there's progress or regress. It's just changing the way those notes are used.
That's right. It's the same vocabulary. I mean, underlying alphabets, for lack of a better word, and you know, they're just used. What's the word? Like an alphabet soup.
Yeah, the language of music or something like that. Yeah. Let's just go through our lightning round now of some of the big questions, just to see where you stand on these sort of. So, if you could be cryonically frozen and come back in 500 years, what would be some of the mysteries today that may be solved? Like, what do we not know now that maybe you guys will figure out or generations they'll figure out?
In terms of physics?
Yeah, like you talk about, you know, uniting Einstein's general relativity with quantum physics. I mean, is that doable? Can that really happen?
Oh, that's a good app. I mean, I do think we'll find the theory of quantum gravity, and I don't know when, but are we close to it?
Explain what that means. So you're talking about subatomic particles and the cosmos.
That's right.
How are they linked? How could they be linked?
Yeah, so, you know, the subatomic world, and I talk about this in the book, the laws that these particles are subject to are called the laws of quantum physics, really weird stuff, okay? And the world of the very large is dictated by gravity. You know, gravity wins over there. It tells planets how to move around stars and things like that, how to fall and go splat. And there is an expectation that quantum things, right, are also subject to gravity. But we don't know how to make quantum mechanics. We don't agree. There are different physicists that have different ideas, so it's very much a debate, and people do research on it, as to how gravity should talk to quantum mechanics. Let's say it's a very mind-bending excursion, okay, to try to make quantum mechanics speak to gravity. They seem to not want to be compatible, irreconcilable differences, you know, like they're not meant to be together. So
this is one of the hard
problems.
This is one of the hard problems to solve.
Yeah, it's one of the hard problems to solve.
By the way, why did Coltrane call these, you know, the interstellar, and he used these scientific, obviously he was interested in science.
Yeah, so in writing this book, I discovered, you know, Coltrane was kind of like my place filler, space filler. For a scientist, you know, like a role model scientist. Because I always expected that he was trying to find his own system, his own pattern, his own geometric system for music and the universe, right? And it turned out that in writing this book, I had the opportunity to interview people that knew him, including other composers like David Amram. And Coltrane's, one of his biggest idols was Albert Einstein. And anything he would get his hands on about Einstein, he would read. And he tried to, you know, he tried to take some of Einstein's ideas, in particular the idea of invariance, the use of symmetry, okay, to elucidate physical law, to try to do the same thing with his music. And it's very interesting that if you look at two very important parts of his career, 59, I think, 59, 60, the Giant Steps, which is like, Giant Steps is based on a symmetric pattern that Coltrane learned from one of his teachers. I talk about it in the book, and that was very complex stuff, right? And later in his life, he did a Love Supreme, and Love Supreme is based on a pentatonic scale. That scale I just played for you. All right, so it's like it all hints at him going after these natural things, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In terms of like, what triggered the Big Bang? What could we even conceive of there being? Is that even the right question to ask? What happened before the Big Bang? What would trigger it? Or how would a scientist try to answer those big questions?
Yeah, I think first of all, the important thing is the right question. So I think that, and what's interesting is that the questions that people like Albert Einstein was able to ask correctly, the right question, turned out to be the ones that we all ask as kids. So is that kind of interesting that, you know, I live in a world where people, like, we do all kind of crazy mathematics and, like, whatever, you know, insane things. We get more and more exquisite and complicated and things like that. But the people that tend to, like, make the breakthroughs are the ones that somehow are able to, you know that stuff, but also go right through it and ask the really baby questions. And so I do still think it's a good question to ask, what happened before the Big Bang?
You know, one of my favorite books in this area was Lee Smolin's, one of your colleagues.
Yes, a very good friend.
The Life of the Universe.
Yes.
I don't know where this stands these days, but let me see if I can summarize it, that there's multiple universes, multiple bubble universes, and say, any universe that has stars like ours must have certain laws of nature, and a black hole collapses and creates another bubble universe. So it would give birth to universes like ours, and universes that don't have stars, that don't have laws of nature that give rise to stars, don't birth new universes like ours. Right. So there'd be a Darwinian selection.
That's right.
So eventually you're going to end up with a universe that has stars and people that ask questions, where did we come from?
That's right.
And universes that don't have those laws don't have people that ask those questions.
Yeah.
Is this idea of the multiverse or multiple bubble universes still a viable hypothesis?
You know, I hate using the word hate, but
well done.
But I used to hate the multiverse idea, but just this morning as I was taking a flight over, it occurred to me, dawned on me, I was like, wait, you know, it might actually be the way the world works. I'm not saying that it is. I provide, at the end of my book, a musical universe analogy for dealing with the problem that the multiverse is trying to solve. So the problem that the multiverse idea is set out to solve a problem that we don't have a solution to right now. Can I talk? Very quickly, the question is, what does it take for a universe to make carbon? Right? What does it take?
Which is what we're
that our universe, the early universe, didn't have carbon around. It was mostly hydrogen. How did the universe produce carbon? It produced it in stars. Stars produce carbon through thermonuclear fusion. Okay, then you can ask, okay, how does a star do it? And how much time does a star have in the cosmic history in the universe to produce enough carbon? Because we're made up of a lot of carbon. So that's why we're asking this question. Right? You can't make us without carbon, right? You can't make DNA without carbon. And it turns out that there's one ingredient in the soup that's needed. It has to do with the electromagnetic force and the one of our nuclear forces. I won't get into what that force is. They work together in stars, those two forces, in some kind of harmony to produce carbon. It turns out that if those forces, they have different strength relative to each other. One force is very strong, it keeps the nuclear matter together. The other is weaker, the electromagnetism. If those forces differed within a few percentage from each other, stars could not make carbon. So then, conditional to have life, the laws of physics have to take on a very specific thing. And we believe that those conditions were created at the Big Bang. So how do you do this? Well, the idea is that, you know, natural selection might do this for us, just as you nicely explained. But so we don't have a theory of physics that, we don't have a meta theory that does that. It's sort of a given to us and we have to live with it, or not. So one of the things that I go into is I'm using this musical analogy and saying, well, as Mr. Professor Cooper taught me, you have an analogy, you push the analogy to the extreme. One thing you might want to do is to take it literally and see if it teaches you something new. And that's what I did in the book. All right, so the idea here is that the universe is improvising, like a jazz improvisation. The configurations of forces, just like Coltrane improvises a configuration of notes, okay? And the thing that's really cool now is that, as I said, you know, you're suspending all this math and all this stuff you know to think at this level where you're kind of coming up with the analogies, but when it's time to get down and dirty, all right, you start playing with the equations, and it turns out that while I was writing the book, me and Marcelo Gleiser, my graduate student, we published a paper chock full of beautiful equations where bang on, the equations worked out, okay? So the title of that paper is called A Cyclic Universe Approach to Fine-Tuning. It's in that.
Okay.
So
this is your response to the theists make the fine-tune argument. I mean, the reason, their answer is God did it. God made it that way. God dialed the laws just right for us, for us.
Yes. Yes.
How convenient.
Yeah.
So this is your response to that.
So the response, in fact, the response to this is even more I would say, cognitively complex than trying to even conceive of, you know, an almighty or something.
Right.
And here's why. Because if you take this analogy serious, that the universe is musical, right, you have to accept another thing in relative, what we call relativistic cosmology. Because in the fact that the universe is expanding comes from a very precise understanding of space and time. That space and time can warp, it can bend, right? It can expand. That quality of nature, of space, comes from this idea of that we call background independence. All right? Meaning that there is no external reference to what the system that you're talking about. Right? Right? It doesn't depend on what frame of reference you are talking about that. It's independent of that. So the universe is independent of who is asking a question or what frame of reference that question is being probed. So that means that if the universe is functioning like an instrument, it is an instrument that is playing itself.
Nicely put.
Right?
I'm going to use that.
It's a song that's playing, it's an instrument that's playing its own song.
So there's no grand music maker out there.
There's nothing outside of it.
I like that.
And so what happens is that once you follow this path, it becomes conceptually like you're like, how can an instrument play itself? Well, that's what the universe is, if it's a musical analogy.
All right, last two questions before we turn it over to the audience. For the kids particularly, what do you have to do to be a great scientist?
Wow, okay. I think it's very important to not get psyched out, okay? First of all, let me say two things. Being a great scientist is not about speed. Like, you know, you'll see a lot, when I was a student, I had like friends, they would feel fast, and they could solve problems very quickly, and they can like take the SAT and ace it. As a physicist, I get a lot of time to work on a problem. It took me 6 years to do my PhD, right? So it's not about who's faster, and don't get psyched out by people who appear to be fast, all right? Roger Penrose is a perfect example I know Roger, we were colleagues together, and he's taught me a lot. Alan Guth, the father of cosmic inflation. Alan is slow as heck, but when he is right, he is right, all right? That's the first thing. So follow your own agenda. I would say follow your own agenda. Don't compare yourselves. We live in a society where that happens anyway, right? We have to take an exam and like you get an A, somebody gets a C. But don't get psyched out by that, right? So follow your own agenda. It's very important to follow your own agenda. Like, you know, the other thing too is there are more than one way to learn the fundamentals. But there is not only one way to learn the fundamentals, right? Look, I hated reading, but I love reading comic books. So I read comic books, and that, you know, helped me. Marvel comic books had great vocabulary in it, you know? So again, like, you know, there are more than one way to sort of master your fundamentals. And the second thing is, you know, follow your passion. I mean, it sounds kind of like, what's the word?
New age-ish.
Yeah, but yeah, just follow your passion. And also keep a keen eye for mentors. Very important. I mean, all I really mean by mentor is somebody that maybe gone through a certain path that is willing to just kind of take you under their wings, right? Because why a mentor could be very helpful is that a mentor could disallow you from reinventing the wheel. Like a way that a mentor might have stumbled in a certain way, they could, you know, prevent you from doing that. They could point you more directly along a more efficient path to success. And then finally, you know, it's gonna sound corny, but there's a big difference between sort of being yourself, right, and how good you are and how good you're not, right? The more that you're comfortable in your own skin, you know, the more that you are cognitively capable of executing great ideas. All right, let me give you a perfect example. I once took an advanced sax lesson from this guy, right? Advanced. I paid this guy $200 for an hour. And he tells me the following thing. I'm waiting for my advanced lesson, right? And he goes, all right, do this. I was like, okay, I can do that. He goes, do that in another key. All right, I did that in another key. He goes, okay, that's a lesson. I'm like, what? I paid you $200 for that? He goes, yeah, I want you to just get that under your finger. Don't think about it. Don't even theorize about it. Get it under your finger in all 12 keys. He said, because when you get out there to improvise, you're gonna make a mistake. He said, that's the whole point of improvisation. Like an acrobat, this exercise will teach you how to fall elegantly. So what the lesson there is that even something as complicated as improvisation and doing science is not about jumping in there and being attached to getting being right on point. It's about making the mistake and learning how to transform that mistake into a new direction, into something new by having the correct skill set, right? So it is about making mistakes. That's how we learn to do two very complicated cognitive tasks, learn how to speak language, how to acquire language. As kids, we mimic and we make mistakes and we learn from that. And learn how to walk, we have to fall a lot, right? So again, come to Brown University and that's how we teach.
That is,
I'm not the spokesperson for Brown University. That's how I teach. All right.
The Jazz of Life, that should be your next book.
Hey, that's a good idea. Think it'll, maybe it'll sell better than this one.
That's it. Well, let's turn it over, open to audience questions. But first, sure. thank Stephon for the beautiful performance. One of the most interesting conversations we've ever had.
Does that mean I get a free glass of wine?
Yes, yes, you get a, and food, yes. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
So Fourier analysis is an interesting technology.
Yes, it is.
And we go through these patterns in the history of physics whereby you think of things in waves and you find out there's particles inside, and then we look inside those things and they seem to behave like waves and we find particles inside it. We've got this point where we've got this huge machinery for Fourier analysis.
Yes.
I think even why we prefer to have a two-dimensional structure of string as the fundamental element from which we compose our three-dimensional reality, which seems like it's kind of like not necessarily constant. You would think we'd have a torus or something like that, but more complex modes of the string. It's easy to calculate the strings.
Yes.
Before analysis.
Yes.
So the question is, I just want to put out there,
yes.
Is it possible that you could solve a lot of these complex problems, like why the electromagnetics and the strong force have the same coupling constant, by actually proposing that maybe charge isn't is a structure that has got three different directions, and the reason why that's the same constant is because it's the same force. If you propose that there's structure inside the things that we treat as waves right now, and how confident are you that that's not the case?
Can you just say the last part of what you're proposing?
That it might be that we could solve a lot of the complex problems that are stymieing the astrophysicists and the particle physicists right now by proposing structure inside of the things that we think of as waves right now. Just like Einstein didn't explain Brownian motion. I mean, what he thought of water as being a continuous medium, and then he looked and said it's got little particles inside. You can see stuff bounces around right now.
All right, good. So I think that's a, so let me see if I can repeat your question so that others.
Technical question.
So basically what you're saying is that, like in string theory, we believe that the fundamental building block of everything, every single thing, the forces and the objects that experience the forces are vibrational strings that carry energy. And the way the analogy is that the different, like a violin string, the different vibrational, the different notes give you different forms of matter, okay? But string theory suffers from this problem as it is very hard to determine these couplings like this for necessary for life. And so what you're saying is that, well, what if the string itself, right, has inner structure, right? Mm. That's a very good point. It's interesting that there was a proposal for string theory at the fundamental called M theory. And one of the M, the acronym M could have stood for mother or membrane, which is, or matrix theory. And that idea in matrix theory does posit that the strings are made of tiny bits of information. But it was very, It got stymied because of fashion, actually. You know, certain people thought it was more fashionable. Mm-hmm. Certain friends at Columbia University,
right.
whose name I won't mention. It's a good point. Yeah, you gave me an idea. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Well, what do you consider your major obstacle?
My major obstacle? Oh my goodness. My major obstacle, too much caffeine.
Academic committees.
So my major obstacle is myself. You know, I think that we tell ourselves stories, and I always have to even writing this book, had obstacles, right? And somehow I had to like plow through it and, you know, write the book. And one way I dealt with that was to be easier on myself. You've written books, and his book is much larger than mine, so he can say something about this, but like, I was like, wait, the publisher wants at least 60,000 words? Like, writing was not my forte, okay? Exactly, it's not my forte. And so instead of like, you know, pressuring myself to write a paragraph a week, I said, you know what, I'm just gonna write 300 words a day. And then it built up, right? So that was one example of.
I think that's probably true for most of us. The biggest obstacle is ourselves. Yeah. I think that's probably true for most people. Yeah.
What's your obstacle, if you don't mind sharing?
No, I would say myself.
Okay.
And that's chapter two in The Jazz of Life. Your biggest obstacle, you. Oh, what?
No, you're going to help
me. I spent my whole life pointing at other people. Yeah.
My mortgage, that's the other obstacle.
Well, there is that. It's like that Eckhart Tolle, Deepak Chopra's friend, who wrote that book, The Power of Now.
Oh, yeah.
And just live in the now. So I did one of these weekend seminars at Salon. 3 days I lived in the now. But on Monday, my mortgage was due, so it's like, oh well. The mortgage company has a different now than I do.
Can you be evicted in the now?
Yes. Anybody
Please,
else?
More questions.
Yes, Simbad?
So we talk about sound and music. And so our ears are having developed to hear sound. Would you say our eyes then are having developed to kind of see music or see sound, and our nose to smell sound or vibration?
That's right. So all the different modes of sensation does have to do with some type of interaction with the external environment. And light waves are vibrations. It's a different type of vibration. It's what we call a transverse vibration. And sound waves are longitudinal vibrations. But it's still vibrations.
There's a good TED talk by David Eagleman. He has this vest that you put on that kind of vibrates. But it responds to sounds that, you know, the audience laughs and he gets a little buzz, you know, and he's like, ooh. And it's a way of like just perceiving the universe in a different, medium.
That's right, yeah.
In this case, sound. But Simba's getting at an interesting question. To what extent do our senses evolve to detect reality? There's this alternative theory that our senses are, just picture your desktop. And like you have a little trash can logo, but if you open the computer, your laptop, there's no trash can in there. And that all of life is like little logos on the screen that we don't know if they're really out there. These are just symbols we evolved to for evolutionary purposes.
Yeah.
Not for truth, to detect reality like it really is, just to detect it good enough to survive and reproduce.
Yeah.
To which I responded, a dolphin will see a shark differently than you and I because they have sonar and so on.
Right.
But sharks really do have sharp, pointy things at one end and a tail at the other end, and they're going to eat you, regardless of what logo is on your desktop. Yeah. And that really exists.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So there must
so
be.
So you say that you can't delocalize into the cosmos.
No, I'm not going to. Yeah, because sharks don't like the power of now. Sharks don't care about my you know, relativistic postmodern interpretation of reality that doesn't really exist. Oh yeah?
Go for a swim.
There we go.
So does the sun emit more like longitudinal electric waves rather than transversal waves? It's more like a mirror.
So we got to repeat that for the camera.
Yeah. So does the sun emit longitudinal waves or versus or transverse waves? Good. So the sun does, on its surface, have longitudinal sound waves, right? That's the field of helioseismology. But the waves that it is, of course, the light that comes to us is in the form of a transverse wave. Let me just clarify the difference. A longitudinal wave is a wave pattern that where the wave actually, the wave in motion is in the same direction as the motion of the wave itself, okay? So if a slinky is a good example of that. If I create a slinky, right, that wave pattern just travels in the same direction that the slinky is waving in. A transverse wave, actually, the waving occurs like an electromagnetic wave, is moving in a perpendicular direction to the direction that the wave is actually moving in. All right, so the wave actually comes to you, like if I look at light, there's a part of that wave of the light that's going like this, that's waving as it's coming to you. And that's why we can make use of Polaroid lenses, right? You can filter out some of that, of the motion. Yes, Mayor?
When you start playing saxophone, do you play by ear, or did you already know how to use
it? Oh, good, yeah. And, well, that's a good point, too, that I want to make. Playing by ear versus reading, and that's also a good analogy for doing physics, because in physics there's intuition, and that's something that Albert Einstein was a genius of, something that Richard Feynman was a genius of. All right, they were able to solve problems that eons of human beings couldn't solve, and it was intuition, right? So they have an inner ear for solving physics problems, and so. I would say that, and so in my case, it's a combination. It's a combination of, when I was a kid, listening to the music that I like to listen to, and trying to reproduce it on my instrument. That's called playing it by ear. But then, there were some times where I had to read the music, I had to learn the scales and that kind of stuff. So I find that it's a dance between both things. I think a lot of musicians, right, we have another one in the room here that I know, it's always a dance between, trying to, enhance one or the other. In my book, I talk about one of the great jazz teachers, and Lenny Tristano, who was a blind pianist. And Lenny Tristano, the way he taught his students, he used to have them memorize pieces, like, solos from greats, and sing it out. So they would have to learn the song as part of the repertoire, as part of learning how to improvise. On top of course, like learn how to read the music. I don't know if I deviated from your point, your question, but so this book is about it's about how does one develop one's intuition, right, or one's inner ear, if you want to take it to music. And when I was in writing the book, I got the opportunity to speak to a lot of jazz musicians as well, but like one of them was Sonny Rollins, Sonny Rollins is interesting because he is known, so many jazz players worship him. Go and they transcribe, they literally like note for note, write down what he played and try to memorize it, or try to analyze it. So let me leave you with a very interesting story. There's this jazz player named Hal Crook who teaches the advanced course on improvisation theory at Berklee School of Music. And you take this class your last year at Berklee. And this is like arguably the top jazz school in America or the world. So Hal Cook does this exercise. He told me this story. He does this exercise where he gives the students a Charlie Parker solo, who is this very, right? This Charlie Parker. And he tells them to go and write and transcribe the solo, write the notes down, and come back with an analysis. And this way, so the students now come in. It's a top jazz school. Everybody's trying to impress the teacher, so they get a job, right? So they come to Howard Crook now. Well, I think he's doing the all intervallic tetrachord and the dominant seventh to the minor third, or the augmented. And he's going off all his theory, right? And Howard Crook goes, "You're all wrong," right? He said, "That solo came about because Charlie Parker was playing at Minton's in Harlem, and this beautiful person walked in the room, and he wanted to impress that person, and on the spot, he played that solo to get the attention of this person, okay? And that's where that comes from.
It all comes down to love, and guys trying to impress you.
Is that why you wrote your book? Is that why you wrote that big book?
Yeah, that's it. Impress my wife, yeah. Well she married me after I wrote. I dedicated it to her. Yeah. So.
Sometimes it comes down to that. Vincent.
You know, the back to that creativity question, because Feynman used to pride himself on not studying some particular area and not reading what other people had already done, so he could come to it with a fresh mind, which sometimes worked really well. And Stephen Jay Gould wrote one of his monthly columns about his first encounter with Feynman at Caltech when he was there visiting, and Feynman had worked out some evolutionary theory ideas without reading anything that anyone had done. And basically, he worked out sexual selection. Mm-hmm. You know, you take something like guppies, the females are kind of bland looking and camouflaged, and the males are brightly colored, and this is sexual selection. The females are selecting for the males who are competing to show their genes by becoming brightly colored, but mm-hmm. of course that makes them more targeted for predators.
Right.
So you have this competition between natural selection and sexual selection.
Yeah.
So basically, Feynman had worked all this out, and he presented it to Gould, and Gould said, "Well, we've known that for like a century and a half now." Oh, never mind.
Right.
Yeah. Well, sometimes it's good to know something about what's already been done.
Yeah, but there's another good Feynman story.
Yeah.
All right. So
yeah, we love Feynman stories.
Oh, in fact, it highlights another thing about the book. Right? I believe I grew up in a particular school of the different styles of Newton physics. So I grew up in what I call the New York Jewish School of Theoretical Physics. So most of my mentors, most of my teachers were of that ilk, right? And the way they taught physics was through storytelling. So there are lots of stories about this and that. But contained in the stories, and this is something, right, contained in the stories was information. So there's one story that my nuclear physics professor, Frank Levin, he would be given this crazy advanced quantum mechanics stuff, and he'd pause and say, "You know, one day, like, you know, there was some workshop in Long Island, and there was this guy who was an a-hole, and his name was Rose. And Rose was this kind of person that would like figure out clever ways of stumping the speaker." So he said this is one poor soul who got up to present 6 months of tedious calculation on something called Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, right? Some insane thing, right? And this guy's going up, you know, presenting pages upon pages of this crazy calculation, right? So that's an easy thing to get, right? Because Rose put his hands up and he goes, "Excuse me, but I think you made a sign error." Because, you know, is the guy going to like try to like, you know, because if you do a calculator for 6 months, there's a really good chance that you're going to make a sign error. And so the poor guy was just like, I can't do anything about this.
Yeah.
All right. The reason why the story came up was that Professor Levin was teaching us Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, and it was painful to experience this. So the story had some information in it. So he said that Feynman was there at this conference. Feynman showed up the next day and went to this poor soul who was already completely demolished, right? He's embarrassed. And he goes, he pulls out like a crinkled up napkin from his inside pocket. And he goes, "Well, you know what? That Rose, he's an a-hole. Like, he's got it wrong. I did the calculation a different way. Here it is. And everything is right. You got the correct answer."
Vindication like, from none other than Feynman. On the napkin, yes. I worked it out at the napkin, yeah. Oh man, I wish I had that intuition.
Right, exactly.
My intuitions don't involve anything so interesting as that.
Yeah, exactly.
Anything else? Yes, sir, up in the balcony there.
I wonder if you could expand on learning and discovery by knowledge. It was a little confusing if you could discuss how it makes sense to me that you learn what's similar. Could you discuss how you learn what's not similar?
Okay, can I say that one more time?
Similar versus, to what extent can you push the analogy?
It's learning through analogy you're talking about, you said that the discovery comes from when something is not similar. It's different.
Okay, very good.
That
stumps
me if you explain
that. Yeah, very good. So let me first say that we're talking about science, right? We're talking about doing science, being a scientist, right? And this analogy thing is more of an art. Because I can just say, this book is like a donkey, right? It's a bad analogy, right? So part of what's going on here is developing a skill, a taste, for lack of a better word, in the art of analogy making. So what you want to do is find something, let me say, something that you know really well. So you have a topic of study that you're investigating, that you're researching. It's unknown, right? So a lot of what we do is we study things that nobody else knows about. If you do your PhD dissertation, you'll be the world's expert in that one topic, okay? Nobody else will know it as well as you did. You're like famous or unknown. How do you begin to understand something that you don't know, that no one knows about? That's the question. The name of the game, you partially know something, you see bits and pieces, is to find something that is well known, that you know extremely, extremely well, and start casting light onto that unknown thing, right? And that's sort of where the analogy made. And then you're gonna find, of course, that it's not the case. The extreme version of this, by the way, is mathematics. Mathematics, and this is where, you know, I'm gonna challenge the skeptic. Mathematics has this uncanny ability to describe physics. I can write down an equation in one line, and I do this from time to time to scare my students. I write down this one equation in one line, and that equation contains three forces with 9 decimal points accuracy, meaning it's like measuring the distance between Los Angeles and New York and being off by the thickness of a hair, right? That's how precise this equation is. But that equation is not the electron, right? The electron is its own thing. It's a great representation of the electron, right? But it's not the electron. So even mathematics, I would say, it's the best analogy we know, right? Now, here's a question for the students. According to this idea, where the analogy breaks down, it's either I'm gonna need new mathematics or something else that's not math. And that's an example of how we, in the extreme case, what your question is.
Well, there is this book, The Mathematical Universe, Max Tegmark.
I disagree with
that.
He's much smarter than I am, okay? But I don't think the universe is mathematical.
I thought of another example of this analogy issue. This week I've been...
I will not tell that to my girlfriend.
I won't mention it. I've been in a sort of contentious war on Twitter with one of my fellow Scientific American columnists. I won't mention his name, but his initials are John Horgan. Anyway, he has this whole thing, you know, that war and violence is a cultural thing, it's a learned thing, and we can teach people not to be violent and warlike and nasty and so forth. And I contend that it's part of the evolutionary logic of survival machines competing with each other, and that there's a certain amount of reputation for willing to hit back or take revenge on people that cheat you and so on. You have to have. Mm-hmm. You know, it begins with Dawkins' selfish gene model and so forth. Anyway, but this guy's a hockey player. So my analogy was, all right, John, when someone slams you into the board, do you say, oh, I'm really sorry, we live in this culture of violence and we're all gonna learn to be nicer hockey players? Hell no.
Right.
You know, you gotta slam back and have a reputation of being a badass so you don't get slammed again, because and that's what I meant by the law. Now, okay, war and sports are not the same, it's an analogy, but in a way, they're not just analogy. There's human behavior.
Is it true that lacrosse was one of these sports or something that if the losers, the earlier version, would get slaughtered?
Oh, I don't know. In that case, it's not just sports.
Sport,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Right. Anyway.
Yes.
So, Simba. Yeah. Are we out of time?
Is there ever such a thing as a not false analogy?
Oh, a not false analogy, yes. But I think your point was that you push it as far as you can go, and then you see there are weaknesses or whatever, but it gets you further than you would have without it.
Yeah, it gets you further. It's a toehold to...
It's a tool. A tool, cognitive tool.
It's an investigative tool.
We have to talk.
It's not the only one.
We have to use language. Right. So if you're not conveying it with this language, you find some other language to get you there.
That's right. And that's why the musical analogy was, it proved to just be continued to be useful. And I pushed it to its logical conclusion, at least in this book.
A non-false.
But as you talked about neuroscience, and, mm-hmm. I mean, every idea that we receive, mm-hmm. we compare with what else? We have mm-hmm. long-term memory that we compare it with. Mm-hmm. And so at some level, that's like an analogy. We don't discover anything that's totally new to us, and we relate it to what we already know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And what I'm saying, as far as that's concerned, I'm not saying anything new. Doug Hofstetter, in a recent book, his most recent book, spoke about just, that actually analogy making is at its core of how we do most things.
Yeah, Gerd Eschel, and the second book was something about loop.
I am a strange loop,
and that's a little bit like the loop. Maybe it's not like quantum loop gravity. I don't know, but
I would not want a guy in New York subway coming up to me saying, "I'm a strange loop."
I'm a strange loop. Okay, dude. back there.
There's such a strong, if not primary, association between music and emotion. Do you ever experience any kind of emotional connection to the musical patterns that you perceive in physics or math?
Oh, great. Oh, that's an awesome question. Mm-hmm. That's really good. I should have. Why couldn't I? Wait, it's too late. But the jazz of life, that's what's
good. That's it, yeah.
But I think, good. So, in other words, music, right? There's certain things I can play, right? That's going to, could make you cry, right? Music has this ability to do mm-hmm. that for some people, right? Some people are just cold.
Bach does that.
Yeah, Bach does that, right? So if I'm making this analogy between musical patterns, right, and then physics, is there something in physics that makes me evoke certain emotions? And the answer is yes, actually. There are, the theory of general relativity, for example, as an example, is so beautiful, that I'm in such awe that when I finally learned it, and I just stared at this thing. I was in such awe of its beauty. Don't get me wrong. I'm never going to fall in love or anything like that by looking at a physics equation. Right? That would be a weird thing, right?
That would be a strange loop.
Can you imagine going on a date and then telling this person, I just fall in love with equations. Let me just show you this equation. I once tried it. It didn't work. Okay.
Match.com. Yeah. Okay. Oh. This is my life. Okay.
Right.
Last question.
Yeah. About Einstein. So Einstein saying that mass is warp states, right? And we have mass that orbit and they send gravitational waves.
Yeah.
Why then do you need a graviton? What would there be for a graviton if it's the actual fabric of space that's
good question. Yeah.
Good question. And it turns out that there are two schools of thought. So the graviton is nothing more than how the electron is a particle and it's a vibrational pattern that's quantized, it's discrete, that's quantum mechanics. There is a quantum of gravity, of the fabric of space-time, called a graviton. And it's postulated to exist, but we haven't seen a graviton yet. We've seen a gravitational wave. And the idea could be that the gravitational wave, right, can lead us to a way of thinking about how to find a graviton. But one idea is that we should not try to, that gravity fundamentally may not be made up of gravitons. And another school of thought is that it should. String theory actually believes that there should be a graviton. It relies on there being a graviton. So if we never find a graviton, you pretty much disprove string theory.
Yeah. But our last guest was Jan Levin in her book about gravitational waves. Mm-hmm. So if there's waves, then unless there are particles that are traveling on the waves or some such thing, or I don't know.
Mm-hmm. So we found the gravitational waves, but it's sort of like water waves, right? But the water is made up of atoms, right? And
oh, so the stuff is waving.
Yeah, the stuff is waving.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Gotcha. Right. Good. Well, very good. So, oh, did you want to? Yeah. Yeah, please. Mm-hmm.
You know how you said that like sound waves repeat, like the C goes over like the 12 notes,
mm-hmm.
but also like gravitational waves and light waves repeat as sound waves do?
Oh,
would there
yes,
be like a fifth
yes, yes,
or a
that's
third?
Right. You mean like the fact that a wave is oscillatory, meaning that its pattern is like this?
Like, you said C goes and 12 notes happen and C goes happens again?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it keeps repeating like that?
Oh, good. Excellent. So the fact, here's an interesting thing. The fact that we actually hear a double, if I double the frequency as similar, all right, that is something about us. Our inner ear, the fact that it perceives similarity for when I double the frequency is right something that, but it's an interesting analogy to push further because it turns out that if you ask yourself the question, why is it that we perceive notes similarly when we go, it gives us a geometry of music, right? Meaning that you end up with a circle. Okay, if I start at C and I go 12 notes, I end up at C again, right? It's kind of similar. And that's really interesting because that, in my book, I talk about this Coltrane's diagram, right? And that idea of cyclic was the idea that I was able to apply to have a cyclic cosmology, a universe that cycles, that comes back to itself, right? So that's an example of the analogy. So what you just did there by asking that question was that you made a nice analogy between sound wave cycles and whether or not gravitational waves can have a similar type of musical structure. And that's exactly the kind of thinking that a good scientist would want to have. And then you can probe that and ask that question mathematically and discover whether or not that's true.
That's one of the great stories of this book, that Coltrane gave this diagram to this Professor Yusuf Latif.
Yes.
And so he calls Latif out of the blue.
Yeah, read that.
Yeah, and he's not here. Well, I think I figured out the meaning of this diagram. He just came back. That's great. Okay. Well, listen, we have enough copies for all of you, for everybody, of the book. So pick that up. You can get it signed here. Stephon will be glad to sign your book, right? And
mm-hmm.
take pictures and so forth. And we have wine and drink and beer and whatnot. And
my handwriting is bad enough that somebody else can sign.
Oh, yes. And food for everybody. And please thank our guests.
Thank you.
That was great. Good job. Beautifully done. Really fabulous.